projector rolling. I have to tell you that you've been experiencing a lot of fun and learning about the history of the Civil War in this area, or whatever you, what have you been calling it, the War of Northern Aggression, whatever you've been calling it.
The recent unpleasantness. Many names.
But almost everything you've been working with has been history, the written word. And when you can touch the material culture, the artifact, whether it's the wool uniform, or the sword, or the cannonball, or whatever it might be, that's a piece of the past, knowing that somebody from the Civil War used that, is a kind of a different experience. So that's sort of what I'm here to tell you about, except that we did the research from the back end, not even knowing that we were stepping into a Civil War mystery. I've been doing archaeology in this valley a long time, and the wonderful reception, you all being here, the people who live here helping me, really has made my career possible and helped me learn. I learn from everyone, and this is why I'm happy to share what I've learned. The story I'm going to tell you tonight is a really cool mystery, and with most science, you have to keep asking new questions. No, it's not that. Well, what's next then, you know? How do we spread some new virus that's out there? What's the latest thing? Equine encephalitis or whatever's out there, encephalitis. You know, you have to keep testing hypotheses and finding out what comes next. And this archaeological mystery story is very positive for several reasons. One is, I get to tell you about the deep, dark, beautiful, beautiful river swamp that I and many of you love so much. And another is, it's the story of wonderful cooperation between local people, helpful public interest groups, professionals, among historians, geologists, geographers, and professional archaeologists. So it's a good story of public archaeology. And third, the reason it's such a great mystery is, unlike most archaeological investigation, we found the answers. You know, usually you look at something, look at this beautiful artifact, it's this shape, it was deposited like this. How come? That's unusual. Must be ceremonial, is what we say. It's a great line. You don't know what it is. They had some weird ritual, they did something. But in this case, we were able to get some answers. So I was very happy about that. Is it working? Getting there? Should I keep talking? Let me see what I wrote down to say. Okay, well, let's see. So we'll start with the location. In a minute I'll show you a map. But you all know from this whole weekend that this river system, come out front, there are plenty of chairs. Come on, I'll get out of this way and stand over here. That this river system goes all the way up into the interior of the South. So it was very important to supply the troops. And who really held, you know, we were talking about, we don't want to talk politics, but let's talk 1850s, 1860s politics. Who held the political power? The cotton merchants in Columbus, Georgia, were worried about what the Union might do if they could make it up the river. So it's important to see that geography. I'll show you the map of where Columbus, Georgia is. How many river miles away? Anybody know? Yeah. well over 200, it's almost 3, isn't it almost 300?
256,
okay. And it's a long stretch of territory to cover. So I have been working in this valley a long, long time. Not up as far as Columbus, but up the Chattahoochee as far as Fort Gaines. I've done archaeological survey on all the sides, the valley sides, to locate sites for the Corps of Engineers, for research purposes, land management purposes, education purposes. I wish the Corps of Engineers would take better care of their archaeological sites on the riverbank, but we won't talk about that. I was going to show you the Chipola River Valley. Many of you know that. Some of you have canoed or kayaked down the Chipola. If you haven't, do it, or at least go park at a boat ramp and look at the beautiful blue water. I've lived in Florida longer than anywhere else in my life, but when I came to Northwest Florida as a kind of a dumb young student, Yankee student, and saw the Chipola River, which was as blue and bubbling as your shirt there, and I was from Cleveland, Ohio, where the blue in the water is from oil spills and chemicals, and I thought, oh boy, look at that. But no, it was from the bubbling blue springs. And the Chipola River figures in our story because, as you know, it starts out really over the Alabama line. A bunch of creeks come together. It comes down through Jackson County and down through Calhoun and into the Apalachicola and Gulf County. So we have this other long river that's very important too. Now we find archaeological sites. Ah, just perfect, because this one needs a picture. All right, we'll pause for a station break. Still loading. No, okay, yeah, it's big. Oh my God, it's big. Well, while we're waiting,
just thinking.
I could give a plug for buying this wonderful t-shirt in the gift shop as a remembrance of this weekend and supporting the museum. Plus, you get all these old guys here, these poor Confederates, and I want you to picture them living in the deep, dark swamp. And I don't know. It's one thing we can't know. It's getting into the heads of the past people, historic or prehistoric. You know, we psychologists, I'm sorry, I don't think much of them, but they can't even get into the heads of people who are living right before them. Like these students are saying, oh, I hope she doesn't talk long because we want to go out and eat dinner. You know, we don't know if they were miserable living in these forts in the deep swamp or if they were having a great time. Oh, I could get away from home and play cards.
We're there.
We're there. Mr. George Floyd. Okay, so here is the site I'm talking about on the cutoff island of the Chipola, and we'll get there in just a second. So here's Columbus, Georgia, way up here, cotton producers. They have to ship it down the river and get it out, and other goods, of course. But when it comes time to fight, they have to have a way of supplying people. And I was going to say that I have worked, you know, on the Upper Valley. The students and I were right there at Chattahoochee Landing a few hours ago. The Upper Valley is still all farms. In fact, some of them are going back to cotton. The Middle Valley, the High Toria Bluffs, and down in the Lower Valley. But pay attention to this area here. We'll get a close-up. Some archaeological sites are easy to find. This is Pierce Mound B on Mr. George Marr's land. Sticks right up out of the ground. So easy to find. Other sites, we have to go looking. We can walk plowed fields. We can look on the riverbank. Here's a nice student with her snake leggings on, seeing what's washing out of the riverbank. In the Lower Valley, we are often taking the beat-up old USF boat. I have to do something on
quick
this.
Cancel.
Cancel. that. Anyway, these are archaeological survey methods, but most of the time we have to walk in the thick swamp. Sometimes we have roads. Almost all the green you see in this picture is poison ivy. That was the upper valley. Here's the lower valley, also poison ivy. You never know what you're going to find in the deep, dark swamp. And of course, the one on the right is me. Actually, this is from Ocala Springs. Creature from the Black Lagoon. Okay. So here we are at the city of Apalachicola, sitting right here. Here's the Chipola River, and its mouth into the Apalachicola, but up here there's a cutoff, and it's 10 miles. Of the cutoff island that you can only get to by boat, and it's thick jungle. You can see it here on the aerial infrared photo, where all the healthy vegetation is bright red, healthy forest. And you can see here's the Chipola, starts in Alabama, comes down here, dead lakes, and then empties into the Appalachian. And as you know, the Chipola is very different, beautiful limestone banks, bubbling blue springs, absolutely gorgeous water. On the Appalachian, below Wewahitchka, some local guys said to me one year, we need to take you to some Indian mounds that are on the cutoff island. And I said, sure. And they put us in their boat, and they took us into where all the Corps of Engineers has piled dredging spoils in the old meanders. And they said the Indian Mound is on Virginia Cut, which is this little stream right here. See that? That shape is going to be very important. This little stream. Over here is Moccasin Slough and River Styx and all these other things. And up here is Corley Slough. All right, so they said we got to get off near Virginia Cut, and we got to walk in. It's about a mile. No problem. When we're done, we'll have a barbecue. It'll be fine. So we slug in there, and it's thick, dark swamp. Thorns rip your flesh, poison ivy, I mean, the whole thing. So we go in, and we find, indeed, there is a mound. Here's what Virginia Cut looked like, little stream. So here's the mound we found, and it had big holes in the top. And we thought, maybe Clarence B. Moore was in there, the famous avocational archaeologist, a wealthy guy from Philadelphia who went all over the South looking at Indian mounds in his riverboat, the Gopher, because he was a digger, and up and down all the southern rivers, and he went in the Appalachian several times. And we thought, well, maybe he found this one, but which one would it be? It doesn't seem to fit any of his maps. But we know he left big holes like that in the middle. So we talked with the state archaeologist, Calvin Jones, who is a legendary guy. And he said, yeah, I've been in there. In fact, I went in there with Randy Daniel, another archaeologist, and we called it the Jones-Daniel Mound, and we gave it a site number, and we're not sure what it is because we didn't find anything in there, but it's a mound. And we got him to go in there with us because it was state land. And he had drawn this picture of the mound with two big holes in it and some little holes. And you could see he was wondering if those are C.B. Moore's test pits. So he did this in 1979, way, way back. And I didn't even know that until I found this. So he said, yeah, let's go back in there. So we went back in. Here's a picture of him. He is now no longer living, but he was so famous. Students loved him. He was from West Texas. And he would plow through those swamps, and I would say, Calvin, you're from Texas. How do you do so well in this swampland? He said, girl, you ever seen East Texas? He said, it looks just like this. So he dug his little shovel test into the side of the mound, and we didn't find too much. But we found two plain surface Indian potsherds And he drew a sketch map, but he said, this is different from the other mound I drew. This one has three potholes. We came to the conclusion that there might have been two mounds. Now, it's so thick in there that you can easily get lost. And for those of you who read murder mysteries, you know what red herrings are? False clues, right? That's what these are. So Calvin wrote up a few things saying maybe they were late prehistoric Indian mounds and so on and so forth. And I said, well, I'm not so sure. And then another archaeologist in the Department of State took that. He'd never even seen them. He took that information and he's had the computer model late prehistoric chiefdoms. There's a Jones Daniel mound. He said, that's one of the chiefly centers, Kaysen and Yan. Here's Pierce. We got Chattahoochee Landing up there and so on right there. And you know, trying to plot the major towns of late prehistory. And I said, John, don't put that in your article because we don't have any evidence yet. He says, oh, well, I want to get published. I want to be famous. And then he had another article where he had the computer draw circles around what were the chiefdoms of late prehistory. Wow, this is how science... I mean, academics are just as goofy as everybody else. Not me, of course, but this is how science is self-correcting. Because I said, you know, we got to get more proof, so we got to go back in there. So we went back in. And this time I thought, I don't really think either of these two mounds is from the prehistoric Indians, because there's nothing. Two little pieces of pottery. If these were late prehistoric chiefdoms, there would be stuff all over the place. Broken pottery and stone tools and shell tools and all this stuff. So here we went back in. Here's Virginia cut. And you can see right here, that little white dot is one mound. And the other one's right over here, this little dot. And I thought, it's not prehistoric. So maybe it's natural elevation. Mother Nature fools us. So I dragged in an FSU geologist and a USF geomorphologist and a soils expert, and we walked all this 1 mile through the swamp and the thorns ripped their flesh too and all that. And we got in there and they said, nope. Mother Nature didn't make these. And the soil was unusual. Oh my God, do we know how to do science. We took samples of the soil. Now my students know I would kill them for showing a slide like this, where you can't read what does all this mean, and you know, but I just want to show you. They analyzed the soil samples we took, measuring the grain size. It was a red, some of it was yellowish, some of it was reddish. It wasn't even the typical soil from that area. They said, no, Mother Nature did not make this. So I said, just like a good mystery-solving person, right, if you have eliminated the impossible, how does that go? Then
you're left with
whatever you're left with, no matter how improbable, is the answer. Not prehistoric, not natural, must be historic, cultural. So I went to Forrester, the guy who runs Neil Land and Timber, great friend, said, hey, show me, would the people going in there logging in the early days have built some kind of mound, maybe to be up above flooding or something? He got out old pictures, old movies. He said, nah, if anything, they would have dug channels to float the logs out. And then he said, probably they never logged in there because the mules would get bogged down. So I decided to go to the courthouse. And when I got to the courthouse to look up who had owned the land, because you could get a chain of title, you could get a history, I found out it wasn't even surveyed in sections. So I went to the lady at the desk in the Gulf County Courthouse and I said, well, how do I look up a piece of land, the history, if I don't even have a section number? And she said, well, I don't know, but you can ask old George over there. George Corr.
Oh, yes.
Who was the clerk of county court in Gulf County for like 50 years. And when I met him, he was 80-something. And I thought, oh, he's an elderly gentleman. I don't want to tax him. And on the phone, he said, yeah, well, first let me get my golf game done, and then I'll meet with you. It was wonderful. I said, what about this area? It wasn't, you know, these mounds. He said, I know about those mounds. I played on them as a kid. Those are Confederate forts. And then I said, well, that's wonderful. But if that's the case, how come they built them deep in the dark swamp away from the river? I mean, we know they lost the war. But they weren't stupid. Why are they building forts in the middle of the swamp? To find out the answer, I recruited a historian in Tallahassee who works for the DEP, Joe Knetch. He looked up all of the documents on the Confederate defenses, found this old map of the river with Battery Cobb and Battery Gilmer. They weren't stupid. They didn't build them back on Little Creek. They built them on what was the river. And you can see Moccasin Creek, you can see the River Styx, you can see this from the Confederate correspondence, and you can see, wait a minute, it's upside down. North is up. Here's north on this one. So if you put it right side up, you see Moccasin Slough, River Styx, Apalachicola, those two mounds. And this curve is today Virginia Cut. And right here is the word obstructions. The idea was they built these forts. They put the obstructions in the river. The Union Navy comes chugging up the river. They can't get any farther. They have to stop. And then they can shoot them. It's a great plan. So the mouth of the Apalachicola, here, well, of course, you know where the Confederate states are. Okay. Remember where Columbus is again, and remember we're trying to get supplies up the river, and the river mouth was silted in, it was hard to get to. We're also studying Old St. Joseph, which is a town they built in 1836, so they could have a deep water port for cotton and not have to go through all the East Pass and silted in channels and all that stuff. They could just ship it right out. Old St. Joseph was a boom town. These are some of the fancy, fancy dinnerwares they used. 1836, what happened? 1841, yellow fever, two hurricanes, boom, town is gone. So antebellum Apalachicola was still the biggest cotton port around, second only to Mobile and New Orleans. But the, and here's where the Confederate forts were, way up here. We'll get back to this slide. But the ships had to get in here to load stuff. And it's very hard to go across the bay. Here's an 1857 map showing the mouth of the river. And it's treacherous. And you who all are, you know, marine folks who know about getting your boats in and out, understand even better than I how you have to navigate this stuff, the currents and the winds and the stuff. So here's where we have the cutoff island, and here's a close-up of Battery Gilmer and Battery Cobb, and you can see that same path of the stream, Virginia Cut, right here with those two forts is parallel. So the river wiggles around here. The river wiggles around here. See it?
Mm-hmm.
And Moccasin Slough, which is just a little diddly widdly slough, because of these obstructions, the river jumped over there. See it? And here's River Styx, just jumped over there. Humans manipulating the environment without major bulldozers. So let's go back to the story. Oh yeah, there are the two forks. I'm sorry, I had more arrows. Let's go back to the story. Well, no, not him yet. Let's go back to this so you can see these places. So the river was a strategic route for supplying the troops over hundreds of miles of the interior. And Apalachicola, the biggest cotton port, of course, selling the cotton paid, paid for arms from England and so forth. Lincoln declared the blockade of the Confederate ports on April 19, 1861. By June 12th, the USS Montgomery, I guess you've heard about it this weekend, huh? The Montgomery was there to blockade the city of Apalachicola. The Union ships were too big to get through the silted in bay. So the blockade runners had it easy on the network of all the smaller tributaries that you don't even see in here. And I'm sure this story has been told better by others during your program this weekend. But the decision makers in Apalachicola put some worn guns on St. Vincent Island to defend the city of Apalachicola. I'm not sure how smart they were. That's 12 miles from town on West Pass, and it leaves East Pass unguarded. Governor Milton was not happy, so he put his own aide-de-camp, named Colonel Richard Floyd, in charge. And Milton kept requesting help from the Confederacy, and he would try to contact General Robert E. Lee, and General Robert E. Lee said, "I'm sorry, we are so busy, and also we don't have any money. You're on your own, guys." Is essentially, I mean, I'm sort of retranslating it, but that's about what he said. "We can't help you. Apalachicola is on its own." Then everyone realized the Apalachicola River led to Columbus, so the Confederate planners thought that they needed fortifications at Fort Gadsden, the old fort from the Seminole Wars, 30 years earlier and 20 miles up from the Gulf. But it was thought to be too unhealthy there at Fort Gadsden. Many of you have been there. So the guns from Apalachicola, from St. Vincent, were sent up to Rico's Bluff at mile 57. The citizens of Apalachicola scattered. Some of them went up to Rico's. Some just went into the swamps, leaving only about 500 people in town, mostly women, children, and slaves. On April 6, 1862, Union blockaders took a few Confederate vessels in the river, declared the city of Apalachicola captured, raised the flag, and left after 32 hours. Meanwhile, upriver, they were also building a fort at Alum Bluff, way up here in the Toria Ravines. And you can go there and see the Civil War gun emplacements. It's really cool. That's a high, high elevation. Then someone suggested, how about the Narrows? That area of twists and turns with Moccasin Slough. How about if we put something there and also put some obstructions in the river? And Governor Milton said, no, obstructions will hinder everyone. But the citizens of Columbus said, yes, we want obstructions. We want you to take care of the Union before they make it up to us. And so General Howell T. Cobb of Georgia and his Confederate engineers persuaded people to construct the fort at the Narrows, which is on the cutoff island, though that was not considered a healthy area either in the hot malarial summer. Joe Knetch located the correspondence between the Confederate engineers. They built wooden trestles in Columbus, way up here, sent them down to the Narrows. They brought down, 265 miles upriver, I already had written it down. And they covered that with reddish sand from 14 miles upriver. I don't know why they couldn't use the sand that was there. Of course it was all done by slave labor. The forts were finished by 1863. Battery Cobb had three 32-pounders. Battery Gilmer had one 24-pounder and a 32-pounder en barbette, which means they swivel. Shoot you, shoot you, shoot you, and you. to halt the boats, the Union boats, the obstructions were placed in the channel. There are the two forts. Here are the obstructions. And they were made up of piles of wood with chains stretched across, sunken boats, and driftwood. And that sure would have stopped somebody, some Union Navy, chugging up the river. Except they never came. They never came. The Confederates stayed about a year and a half, abandoned batteries Cobb and Gilmer on July 1864, when the inspectors, and we have their reports, said what terrible shape the forts were in, and we must dismantle them right away. Meanwhile, the threat to Columbus came not from the river, but overland, west through Mississippi and Alabama. In January 1865, the Union forces moved inland from St. Andrews Bay, east on smaller streams and overland to Chipola, then the Apalachicola River, above the obstructions, attacked Rico's Bluff and Fort Gadsden. Meanwhile, the Apalachicola River had already jumped to Moccasin Creek. Governor Milton, in despair about the way the war was going, returned to his plantation in Mariana and shot himself on April 1st, 1865. The war ended shortly after, and Florida's surrender came about 2 months after Milton was gone. In the late 1860s, Florida was still petitioning Congress for funds to remove the obstructions or enlarge the passage through Moccasin Slough, because nobody could get through. The jungle had reclaimed its own. Knowing these were Confederate forts, we went back, this time with metal detectors. Here's a student. Here's our historian, Joe Konech. We dragged him through the swamp with the thorns ripping his flesh and everything. And he had a great time. And we did some proper archaeological, just short, small testing, because we don't want to do more disturbance than we have to. We mapped, and we came up with nice topographic maps. So here's Battery Gilmer. They're not Clarence Moore's potholes. They're ramps for rolling the cannon up. This shows you the artifacts we found. The red things, I tried to make them red or pink, are the metal artifacts that we could find with metal detectors on Battery Gilmer, the smaller one. And here are some of those artifacts, including, you know, here's an old spike, a piece of a hinge, an old nail, and, you know, they rust and they look like giant dog turds or something, but they're heavy. They're heavy and orange. This thing is apparently a fuse auger for use on the cannon. Battery Cobb had the three holes, which were for the three guns, and you can see here's where we got those little prehistoric potsherds. And of course, that sand had come from 14 miles upriver. So they were brought from somewhere else. And then you can see the pink, again, are the metal artifacts we found. And we also got some historic crockery, pieces of little dishes. The old road was still visible near Battery Cobb. You can kind of see it here. We mapped it in. And here is some more of the artifacts from Battery Cobb. Again, spikes, a piece of a hinge, and so on. Here's the china. It wasn't really china, but pink transferware, transfer print, blue and green. Very beautiful stuff. And here's the other end of Virginia Cut, close to where it comes out on the river below. And you can see how big it is today. Here are the students mapping. Here's an old timber. You know, a cut piece of log. From that channel, we got this thing, a big rusted spring. I still haven't been able to identify whether it's from a, it looks like a giant safety pin, doesn't it? It's about this big, all rusted. I haven't been able to identify whether it's like something from a wagon or something. But interestingly enough, we also were able to find the obstructions. And it's another part of the adventure. Oh my God, we're in the middle of, we're a mile in the swamp. And all of a sudden, thunder, lightning storm. I'm thinking, oh my God, not only am I going to die, I'm going to kill the students. Now what do you do if you're in the middle of the forest? You don't want to go near a tree. Where are you going to go? And it was cold and we were just miserable. And as usual, one of the local folks who was with us said, we can stand here and be miserable, or we can walk east and try to look for those obstructions while we're being miserable. And I said, great. We walked east. And that's Pat Millender and Jimmy Moses. You may know them from town. The most fantastic thing is, of course, I was bringing up the rear, making sure the students weren't getting snake bit as they walked. And I hear yelling up ahead, hey, look what we found. We found the obstruction just as the sun came out. We found the obstructions. They're big pieces of metal sticking right up out of the forest floor. Where they're all standing was the river. And it all filled in with all this stuff over time. And I tell the archaeology students, to be able to do archaeology well, you have to have a course in geomorphology. How do shapes and landforms on the earth get made? How can we account for the way they look? And sometimes humans make them that way. So, my important points for the day, take notes, this is the thing that will be on the quiz, right? Here's the quad map, the USGS quadrangle map. So you can see the Apalachicola River. You can see what today is called Moccasin Slough. It used to be this thing. And today the river Styx is here. It used to be this thing. You can see Virginia Cut, which is the old channel of the river. You can see the two forts, Battery Cobb and Battery Gilmer, with their state site numbers, GU-14 and GU-94. You can see where the obstructions were, another little bit down here. And you can see where the dredging spoils, I've outlined them in dotted lines, where the Corps of Engineers piles up the stuff they dredge out of the river bottom. When I gave some of, yes, the Corps. That's my sweetheart name for them. Some of you may know Helen Light. She's a fabulous geomorphologist who works on this river. And I was given some of this talk once, and she, because Coralie Slough is right up here, she says, that's amazing. Are you sure about that? I said, you can read the history books. The Confederate documents are there. She said, because the dredging is always the most at Coralie Slough, because the river wants to fill in. And I said, well, that's why, because it used to be there. It's trying to get back to where it once belonged, And so the big messages are, little things we do, or kind of big things we do, can have repercussions forever. The ancient Egyptians didn't need to invent the line level to make sure their pyramids were built right. They just diverted the Nile, right? You can tell how to build things. People are always manipulating landscape. If you think you've walked into virgin forest, you're wrong. The Amazon, now we have wonderful archaeological data. Now that we have all those spy tools of seeing through the jungle, we see that the ancient Indians were making canals, were making 40-mile-long causeways, were planting nut trees where they wanted them. And people are always manipulating the landscape. Second, even huge things like the Civil War, like forts, that's part of the history of this area. But memory fades. And George Core didn't even know the answer to why they were, he was 90, whatever, I think he died in his 90s very recently, but he could not answer the question of why those forts were not on the main river. All of that information fades, and we have that subjective retention of memory. But if you go back and check original sources, sometimes you find it's wrong. That's where archaeology is great, because we can either confirm history with archaeological evidence, or we can contradict it, or third, we can find something new that history didn't even write about. And finally, real scientific archaeology gives you a picture that history and other documentation doesn't. But it needs real data, real material data, even if they are from the deep, dark swamp. And that's my presentation. Here's a picture of Virginia Cut today, what the river now looks like, now that it's had most of its water taken away. It's just a little pretty stream. I'll be happy to take your questions, and I'm so glad you came out today to hear me and to support public archaeology. Question?
Have you ever thought about going back and possibly finding the actual campsite?
I wondered if that was going to come up. Well, here's the thing. First of all, it's state land. It's supposed to be protected. There was a gentleman in Wewahatchee, a very prominent gentleman, who read about this and decided to go in there and start digging up a bunch of stuff. And he called me and he called the state archaeologist. Say, yeah, I want to find, I think there might be a cannon in there. I want to find a cannon, put it in downtown Weewaw. And he dug this huge hole. Oh my God. You know, that's illegal on state land. So the state archaeologist, Mary Glowacki, fabulous state archaeologist, and I went out and he said, I uncovered something, I don't know what it is, I don't know what it is. Well, it was an old pull boat from logging days. And the state handled it. I just went along, you know, for the ride, and as far as I know, I don't know if they took it out or covered it up again. I know he was only interested in trying to display the past, maybe, in Wewahatchee, but he should have known the law. Let me just say that what he did for a living was something in which he should have known what the laws were about digging on state land. I know people wanted to find where the camp was. There is no documentation we have for where the actual camp was. Probably it wasn't far away. In order to find it in that swamp, we couldn't even do ground penetrating radar or any of that remote sensing, because you gotta push those on like a sledge. And if you got trees and vines and stuff, forget it, you know. We have to wait until we get the Star Trek tricorder. Beep, 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 beep. Oh, there it is, you know, something like that. I speculate about what those guys, and who knows, there may have been women too, were doing in there. There were all those little back streets where they could go in and out anyway. They probably were either bored out of their gourd, or somebody did supply them with alcohol and dice and playing cards and musical instruments and, you know, or maybe a combination of the two. It was hot and wet, and whether they were miserable or not, remember, they didn't have air conditioning. And there are many people who are perfectly fine when it's hot and wet, and they're not miserable. But we don't realize that today, because we live in controlled air situations. So I don't really know that answer. It would be fascinating to do that. But since it's protected land, I have not gone in to look for it. It would mean a major expedition. It would probably be $250,000 just to begin to do the archaeology, to find the camp.
I guess my question, they were there for a year and a half, right? And they were there, so they were near the fortifications. And somewhere in that vicinity, they would walk back and forth daily or put watches.
Well, yes, and we did little teeny tests. Yeah, we did little teeny tests. We didn't find much. Those three pieces of crockery, which you would expect at a camp or eating off of dishes and stuff, they were on the slope of the gun. I don't think they would have wanted to walk far.
Did you take hand metal detectors and look for any other artifacts off of the site?
Oh, yeah.
You never found anything close by? Really? Interesting.
Remember, the river silts in.
Sure.
The river piles up. Across from Chattahoochee Landing is the prehistoric archaeological site I studied for my doctoral dissertation research. The initial deposits, the prehistoric deposits, are a meter and a half deep, almost 5 feet deep, because when white folks and black folks came in and deforested the land and planted huge plantations, yes, the Indians had cornfields, but not, zillions of acres of cotton, all that wash off goes down and gets dumped on the riverbank, and it covers it up. So I don't know. There may be a camp in there, or maybe they took everything out, cleaned up everything, and didn't leave anything.
That's not their nature.
Well, no, but it's possible.
In those days, they used the ground as a trash can.
Yes. Good thing, otherwise I wouldn't have a job.
Exactly. That's true.
Yes.
That is true.
The old road, is that from the same period, and kind of where did it go?
I think so. We followed it, and it just kind of died in the swamp. But it must have been how they brought in things. Remember, though, it's a cut-off island, so after they unloaded them from a barge, and they unloaded the horses and a mule, whatever, in a wagon, and then there were the ox, and then they probably pulled the cart down the road, is what I'm speculating. Yeah.
When you were comparing the old and new river courses, did you happen upon any other instances along the Apalachicola where the river had shifted significantly?
Well, actually, the river is always shifting. And if you look up in Jackson County on the west side of the Chattahoochee and Calhoun County, if you look at a topographic map, or even if you go on Google Earth, you can see, I might have a picture of it here. You can see the, you can see old meanders and oxbow lakes that are curved like this, because those are old channels of the river. The Apalachicola and the lower Chattahoochee have been moving eastward since they were born, and when the Ice Age ended and the sea level rose and backed up the mouth of the Appalach, it started moving eastward. And so you have lots of old channels naturally made. Whether people made any or not, we don't know. In South Florida, where the Indians did dig canals, we have clear evidence of that. And I think over in Walton County, one archaeologist found evidence of an Indian dug canal in Choctawhatchee Bay. I think that's what it was. But we don't have any evidence yet here of prehistoric Indians rechanneling the landscape. But hey, I'm sure if they needed it, they would have done it. The thing is, the river's so active and dynamic that it could have filled it back in and moved on. So
there's a story about the gentleman from Chicago in the 30s who was going to come down here with a team and haul out a steamboat that had sunk decades before with a load of whiskey on it, which he calculated would be worth a fortune.
Oh, man. Well aged. Yeah.
Yes, very well aged. He was hoping it was all still nicely preserved in the barrels beneath the river.
Wow.
And so he came down here from Chicago, and he was trying to find out where this wreck was. And he interviewed an elderly dock worker. And the dock worker said, basically, I can't talk to you about alcohol on the Sabbath, but if you come back tomorrow, I'll take you to where it is. And the site was, I can't remember the exact distance, but it was a significant distance from the river channel, and the wreck was beneath about 20 feet of mud.
Yep.
And so the guy from Chicago gave up and went home. And if you're ever tromping around out there in the swamps,
was it
near
Whiskey George? Is that how I got the name?
Maybe so. But let us know if you ever find a fortune.
Oh, you don't know where it was?
I still don't know. But
so
I might
have to sample it if we do find it, just to make sure it's the real stuff.
We'll have a sampling party.
Yeah. Yeah. That'd be great. Okay.
Any Any other questions? Will y'all join us out on the dock? We'll have a little wine and cheese and refreshment and chat with Dr. White a little bit more. Thank you all so much for coming to this final event of our Civil War History Weekend. It's been a lot of fun and a big success. We appreciate everybody for...
And buy t-shirts.
Many a soothing strain.